thank you for coming. My name is Adam Szlachta. I work in Hokkaido, and professionally I don't use Haskell, unfortunately, but I'm a big fan of it. And this is a very special language for me because it's a purely functional language. So basically you can do stuff like sequence operation one after another. So this is the plan of my presentation. I will talk a very little bit about what is Haskell, what kind of feature it has, and I will introduce gradually more and more advanced patterns how to use Haskell. All right. So. Basically, we don't have so many pure programming languages because all languages we understand, we know as functional programming languages, or most of them, are not really pure. They can do some side effects or some stuff which is known from imperative languages. So, but there are a couple of pure languages, and most of the most known of them is Haskell. It was influenced heavily by Miranda, but still Miranda is not so much popular. Anyway, Haskell is the name of Haskell is taken from the name of Haskell Brooks Currier, and he was a mathematician and logician. It's made of Lambda calculus, like all of functional programming languages. It has a history, obviously. This is generally the history of programming of functional programming languages. So it started a really long time ago in 58, the first Lisp. And as I mentioned, it was heavily influenced by Miranda, but also some other languages. It also influence Scala. Some of you knowing Scala maybe also know Scala Z, which is a library very heavily influenced by a standard library of Haskell type classes. All right. So I address basic features of Haskell. So it says strong static typing. The type inference means that the type signatures of methods, of functions, can be inferred. They don't have to be provided. Of course, it's usually good to provide them explicitly, but they can be inferred. First class functions, carrying lazy evaluation, these kind of things. Mutability, algebraic data types, higher order types, monads. I'll be talking about more or less all of those features in this presentation. So, generally, functional programming is about avoiding side effects, about avoiding heading state. So, in case of Haskell, it's not only avoiding, you cannot explicitly do side effects or this explicitly deal with state. You have to make it in a purely functional way. Because all the expressions, at start, all expressions in Haskell are expressions. So they have to be evaluated to a single, they can be evaluated to a single value, theoretically. And that gives the possibility of having real referential transparency. And also, theoretically, at least, lazy evaluation. So Haskell is based on theories. At least two of them are very, very important, which is Lambda calculus, all of you probably know, and category theory, which is what I will be focusing more in this presentation. All right, so basically I start with a very, very basic example because I assume that not all of you know Haskell. By the way, how many of you are familiar with Haskell? All right, so at least half of you. Good. So this is very basic Hello World program. There is a type signature, which is main, double colon, and IO, which is monad. The other example is a little more sophisticated factorial function, which takes integer and yields integer. So the arrow means that there is some value taken and some arrow produced. And you have two definitions of factorial, which is a definition for zero value, for a specific value, and for a generic value, which is n. Below you have the definition of main function, which is starting with do. Do is a keyword, it's just a syntactic sugar for monadic binding. I will be talking about that later. So here I just told that in Haskell all functions have to be expressions, but it doesn't look like that. It looks like sequencing operations one after another. Just print something, get some input, and print something else. But in fact, this is just this do keyword is, as I mentioned, the syntactic sugar for monadic binding. So all of those so-called operations are in fact the functions which are glued together with a monadic binding. Okay, let's go on. So the difference is that yes, these type signatures can be derived, can be inferred. All right, so this is a philosopher. I mentioned about him on another occasion. He's the author of expression referential transparency, which is widely known. The function is meant to be referentially transparent if you can exchange the call of function with some arguments if its result in any kind of context, and it would be the same. So he was a language philosopher, so he was thinking about this kind of sentences, like in this in the first example, the capital of Poland could be easily exchanged in Warsaw and the meaning would be the same. But in some other contexts, it's not true, like the last sentence. Of course, you cannot exchange the capital of Poland with Warsaw because that would not make any sense. Anyway, in functional languages, a factorial of 8 can be replaced with the actual value of it, and it's just the same. So all of expressions in Haskell are meant to be referentially transparent. All right. So this is an example of a function which calculates something, which also has to do something to calculate something first, the S. It's a formula to how to calculate it's the area of the triangle. So in Haskell we can do I wouldn't call it variables, but it's named values. In this case it's S. It's a roughly the same as val in Scala, or some final values, primitive values in Java. So you can do it in two ways. I'm more or less equivalent with a let keyword and with where. So in the first case you define the helper values first, and in the other case you do it after. There's a very slight difference between it, them, but it's not really interesting here. All right. As in the previous example, the type signature can be inferred. So why we have multiple arrows here is also quite an important thing, because we can think about this function as a function which takes three arguments and yields one, double. But we can also think about this like a function which take one argument, and here it's a function which takes two arguments, or a function which takes one argument, and here's a function which takes another argument. So it's really equivalent. All of the thinking about this type of signature is equivalent. All right. So very basic features of Haskell. They are built in lists using square brackets. So strings are just a list of characters. This is a single character. This is a generator of values. This is I put type signatures there. So this is this T means that this is the type of the list of type generic type T, and this T has to belong to the class enum and num. In this case, this is the definition of infinite list. This is the definition of the list which is decreasing. The list which is every second number, and so on. So it's in most functional languages we have similar things. Also the list comprehensions, which are list generators based on some kind of formula, and of course we can also provide some conditions which numbers put to the list. Or which kind of values. It's kind of important because this can be also written in a monadic style, which I will be showing later. All right, we also have a built-in tuples. So in tuples we can put values with different types, like a character, the list of characters, function, or another function. For example, if we type in the interpreter of Haskell colon T, which means give me a type, it will write that this is the function of this type and the function of this type, the plus and the head. All right, carrying is a property of functional languages, some of them at least. In which you can provide just not a full list of arguments to the call of the function, and it will yield another function which will still work on the remaining arguments. So there are some examples. Nothing really. Oh, for example, at the end, ordinary add, which is two arguments function, yields A. If we define another function at 5 and define it like that, providing only one argument, the type of it would be just one argument less. All right. So the typical functional idioms use map, fold, and lambda expressions. We could already see it in the previous presentations in Scala, and it was in Scala. So Haskell is the same. We can provide lambda expressions. We can think about this like an anonymous inline function, something like that. We can make a shorter notation. So map fold. Fold is a way to combine all of the values in a list to the one value, starting with some initial value. For example, some of the all elements in the list is just a fold with providing the function which adds the numbers and starting with zero. The product will be starting with one. So we can here we can see that we can write it straightforward by providing the lambda expressions, the initial value, but we can, instead of providing lambda expression, we can just put one operator which also acts as a function with two arguments, and if we can even skip the argument, the parameter. Because it's the same on the left, on the right side. And we call it point free notation. So, for example, this sum of x's, the list of x, it can be just shortened to fault R. R and L means that from which side we start, we are starting to folding this list. Anyway, there are very, very basic things about Haskell. Haskell is a lazy language by default. Of course, the strictness is possible, but the idea was to... It was actually the initial idea of people who started Haskell, invented Haskell. Lazy evaluation means that if you don't need to evaluate an expression because it's not necessary for the result, you just don't do that. Non-strictness is very, very similar idea. I will not focus on it. I guess you don't have time. Anyway, we can do it in Haskell. So in the first case, this is just an evaluation of expression f of x, and then a g of this result. We can, instead of parentheses, we can use a dollar, which is an operator of applying the arguments to the function, but with a low priority. So that's why we can skip the parentheses here. And if we add the exclamation mark to dollar, it will be strictly evaluated. So it will be evaluated at once, not without waiting. Because of lazy evaluation, we can use infinite data structures, like the list from 1 to infinity, and it works. Because it won't be evaluated until it's needed. And the function, for example, take 10, it's a function which evaluates the first 10 arguments. All right. Algebraic data types will be necessary later. So it's a way how to make some structures in of the data types in Haskell. Very similar thing is in Scala, it's case classes. So we can use the alternative, we can use the recurrence in, for example, this is 3A. We can use parameterizing. So for example, Boolean is not parameterized at all, but list and or tree is parameterized by any kind of A. All right. So in Haskell, we can also put some identifiers to the algebraic data types, like number, first name, this kind of. So it's similar to structures known from other languages. In this case, we can also skip the identifiers and just define it like it. So account is, this is the data constructor, this is the type constructor, which is a different thing. And it consists of one integer, one string, one float. That's just a very basic example. But I will focus more on this kind of examples, like this tree, because it's parameterized. And this is an example of custom data type. We can think about this like as a custom collection. And why is that? This is also an example how to go through the tree of and calculate something by using the pattern matching. We can pattern match using the case keyword, or we can pattern match using the function definition. All right. So we are closer to the more interesting things. So the class defines the operations we can do, or the set of functions which are necessary for your data to belong to that class. For example, the class equals is a class of data which provide an equal and not equal operator. And this is an example, a definition for the tree I just showed before. There is only one condition that the A, the parameterized type, it should belong to the class equal, which is a standard class. All right. Now we are almost there. So the standard library of Haskell has a lot of type classes. So I tend to call them sometimes programming patterns, because we use it in a very similar way as a programming patterns. So functor is just generalization of map. Applicative functor is something. So you provide a function, kind of structure, and it will calculate this kind, the same kind of structure collection with applying this function. It has some laws and so on. This is an example of the implementation instance of functor for the tree. All right, monoid is also taken from category theory, and it provides the empty value and the way to appending the value to the former values. So the best way is to show some examples, so adding, multiplying, or and operators, and also concatenating the strings are examples of monoids. So everything which can be somehow appended to other values of the same kind, which is very important, and it has to have a natural value. Like for summing is zero, for multiplying is one. It's important because they're just examples. You can also read this presentation after. So there are just some examples in Haskell. But what I want to mostly talk about is monad. So it's also taken from category theory, and the definition sounds a little complicated, but it's a very simple thing. The monad is something which can provide a default boxing and default unboxing for double box things. sounds quite weird, but it's just something which, for example, if you think about an example, the M can be a list, or maybe is a Haskell way of optional for known from Scala. You have two operators, which is return, which provides the default boxing, and bind operator, which provides the way to combine expressions into one chain. So you box something, you have some functions which take this red something from inside and produces the box, and because it's double boxes, you have boxed, you have to unbox it. In Scala, it's known as flat map. So this list comprehension can be written in monadic style using do keyword. The do keyword is just a syntactic sugar from combining the monadic operations one after another, which consists of lambda expressions. So why it's very typical pattern in Haskell, because it shows that using just ordinary expression, just a purely functional word, you can express this kind of things, like maybe it's something like a null reference, something to handle nulls, or something to help handle failures. Either also can switch to the same things, but with some error message. Array to non-determinism. There are also definition of monadic binding, so we can see this is very simple. And using the monadic expressions, you can avoid this kind of boilerplate code. And in Java, there would be a lot of null checks in this case. You can just write like this the binding operators, and behind the scene, it will handle all of the checks. And this can be also changed into do operator, do keyword, and do notation, which is very simple. In Scala, it is for comprehension. And I will skip that. We have, yeah, this is the most interesting part, except maybe and either monads. You also have reader, which suits to, like, if you have an environment of kind of global data and you want to get these values in your calculation and to use them without putting some boilerplate in your code, you can use this monad. Writer is something which takes monoid, what I just shown, and you can append to some kind of log, or you can append to some something using this monoid just during the calculations and not combining them with the calculations. So it's kind of separated. And a state is just a way to emulate having a mutable state. So instead of passing many arguments or a tuple with many kind of arguments and getting them, you can simulate the state using the state monad. So they are definitions. They are not very easy to understand at first, but the use is very simple. So in case of reader, you can just use the do notation and the helper function like ask, which takes the value from the environment, like configuration, whatever. This is just an example. Writer monad writes to log, so along with some calculations, I can produce some log what was done or anything else. In this case, it's an evaluation of a factorial function with of a factorial value with some string, and the function used here is tell, which works inside this monad. And the last one is the state. It's a very basic thing. You can use get and put helper functions, which also work inside the monad, and they can get the state and put on the state. So using this monad, you can simulate any kind of stack, any kind of mutable state. But still, it is just an ordinary expression. If you change the do keyword with binding operations, it will be one expression. All right, so this is all. This is just a summary of the standard monads in Haskell. There are some more, like continuation passing style. I wasn't talking about I/O, but it's a little bit different. So it's not interesting. Some links at the end. You can check them later on. I think this is the most important. So the last thing is that you cannot combine monads very easily because it's impossible. You have to use monad transformers. So I didn't tell you about everything, but this is just a very basic way to simulate this very imperative style behavior, like exceptions, mutable state, writing to logs, reading from global data, this kind of things. Still being in a purely functional world. Thank you.
Any questions? We have time for one question. Question?
So that's maybe not a question, but a comment. So the thing with monads is that they are very, for non-Haskell, they're hard to understand. So much so that whenever one understands monads, one actually usually writes in monad tutorial for others to understand.
Yes, it's actually.
The way that helped me to understand monads is to think them about them as enriched functions. So usual Haskell functions are just things that transform input to output. And monads can do more than that. They can maybe monad can transform input to output, but also fail. Maybe monad can transform input to multiple outputs and so on. And you get to define the composition of such enriched functions and express all sorts of intelligent things.
Yes, it's completely true. Yes, of course. I didn't want to call my presentation something with monads, just to avoid another monad tutorial. And I just provided some examples. I didn't want to explain what is this. I don't know what is this. It's just a pattern.
Okay, thank you.